Okay, so thank you, Hans, and thank you, Bruno, for this very kind invitation. And before starting, I would be pleased to say a few words about the feeling I have today, which means 30 years later. So in the early 80s, I was teaching at the DEA, the Physique Théorique, at Lumini. I was in Nice at that time. And that's where I met Alex. Not only Alex, but also Thierry, many people of the Marseille Wavelet School. I was very lucky because very quickly, I was considered almost as a member of the family. Of course, the family grew up very quickly. And as in any family, there has been a lot of happiness and sadness. As people were saying yesterday, Martin, there was also a lot of success and disappointment. There was a lot of excitement and discouragement. But all over the years, I think the feeling 30 years later is there has been a lot of friendship developing. And I know why. There has been a lot of friendship, kindness, generosity in the field because, and that's why I want to say, because we have to thanks Alex for being the one that has, how to say, defined the path, defined the road. Yes, to be the guide. I want to thank Alex for having helped me, but help a lot of people, finding our own way, our own road in the field. So today, Alex, you know that you have many kids. Now you have even more grandkids that we are here, okay? Yes. Alex, you are a very sexy guy. But there is something I don't know if you realize, is how proud we are to be one of your kids. So thanks, Alex, for all those years. And thanks to have followed at least my group to come in Bordeaux to see what we were doing all over the year. It was a great, great help. So now let's start. And okay, to see how happy I am, I'm going to do a show today on topless women. And next time, if I am still invited, it will be bottomless. Next time, okay. So, I know, good question. Because breast cancer, I can answer immediately. Surprisingly, men can have breast cancer. Less than 1%, but men can have breast cancer. So breast cancer is not only for women. Okay, so I start acknowledging. So I'm going to do two things. The analysis of X-ray mammograms. X-ray mammograms is you have at a given time or photographs high resolution in space, X-ray, but no time evolution. Then I will switch to thermograms, infrared thermograms. Poor resolution in space, but every second you have 70 pictures. So you can follow the dynamics. And we're going to combine both analysis. And to do this analysis, mammogram collaboration with a former student of mine from Quebec, André Khalil, who is now at University of Maine. And for the thermogram, it's a collaboration with people in Perm in Russia and the hospital over there where they are doing infrared thermogram analysis. Okay? Now, okay, just one thing that I don't know if you are aware about. For women, Breast cancer is by far the most dangerous one, which means statistics all over the world. 100,000 women, you have about 40 that are diagnosed breast cancer, and you have about 12 or 13 that die. And you see all the other ones are, for example, here is lung cancer, this is ovary cancer. So all the other ones are much less dangerous. So which means there is clearly a need to improve diagnosis in the field. Okay, now, okay, let's switch. What usually doctors are doing, analyzing mammograms, they look for, you could say they have to distinguish between kind of opacity that are malign or not, architectural distortion, and the appearance of microcalcification. Okay, and what they are doing, in some sense, is mainly based on when they see microcalcification, whether the microcalcification have invaded the branching canals, milk canals, or not. By the end. Okay, how can we help as a physicist involved in a kind of wavelet-based multifractal analysis, rough surface analysis, can we help in the diagnostic of mammograms? So what we have done is this. We have used Stéphane, where is Stéphane? Stéphane Mallat, definition of the two-dimensional wavelet transform, which consists, as you see here, you have a rough surface that can be a mammogram. The wavelet transform in 2D is a vector at a given scale. And what Stéphane has done, it has defined this wavelet transform in 2D as the convolution of the image, one on the x direction with the first derivative of the Gaussian 2D Gaussian function along the x direction to quantify variation along the x-axis. And the second component is the same thing, the convolution, with the derivative of the Gaussian function along the y. Then you can show very easily that your 2D wavelet transform is a vector with some modulus, some direction, okay, which is nothing but you convolve your image with the Gaussian at a scale A, and then you take the gradients, which is what was done in computer vision analysis to do edge detection. Now, on what does it mean? It means that if you look at the maxima of the wavelet transform modulus along the gradient direction, you get the, at a given scale, you get these, which are the edge of the smooth image by the Gaussian at a scale A. Okay? Now, you do that at different scale, large scale, all along, and we're going to define what we call the wavelet transform skeleton, which means along at a given scale, along the maxima line, you look at the modulus, it increase, then it starts to decrease. You keep only in the computer the spatial point here and the 2D wavelet transform vector. This is called the maxima of the wavelet transform modulus maxima. So you do that at every scale, and then you connect those points across the scale to define maxima line, and this is the wavelet transform skeleton of 2D images, which are that is going to contain the information about the roughness property of your surface of your image. And now you have two situations. Along those maxima line, what you can show is that the modulus of the wavelet coefficient decay as a power law to some exponent, h, older exponent that was defined yesterday by Stéphane Jaffar. If along all the maxima line, you get the same power law decay with the same older exponent, h red, this means that your surface is monofractal. At every point, the singularity strength is as the same, corresponds to the same value of this scaling exponent, the other exponent. Now, you can have to end with a situation where the scaling exponent on the maximal end change color from line to line. Okay, so you have a whole spectrum of order exponent value that quantify the fact that your rough surfaces, the roughness fluctuate from point to point. Okay, so which means in this situation, your rough surface is called multifractal surface, multifractal image. The order regularity fluctuates from point to point. How to quantify this? So Stéphane explained yesterday. So you're going to quantify this by what the so-called singularity spectrum. The so-called singularity spectrum means when you are multifractal, you pick all the points where the order exponent is H red. It's a fractal set. It's a subset of points of the plane. The fractal dimension of this subset is called D of H red. And you do that for every H. If you are multifractal, you have a power, you have a singularity spectrum D of H will look like a bump, like that. The color that you see the most in your surfaces is the one corresponding to the maximum dimension here. This is a dimension spectrum. When you are monofractal, you have only one color. Okay, how to compute D of H? The best way to compute D of H is to do some kind of statistical analysis inspired from thermodynamics. This is a multifractal formalism. But which amount to do what Stéphane has tried to define yesterday, which means at each scale, you look at the coefficient at that scale, you look at the distribution of value of those wavelet coefficients, maxima, and you look at the moments. You look at the moments here of those wavelet coefficients at scale A. And you look at the way each moment corresponding to different Q value, how they scale as a function of the scale. They should scale as a power law with some exponent that I call tau of Q and that Stéphane called zeta P. With the wavelet transform modulus maxima, the advantage is since the modulus maxima cannot be zero, by definition, you can compute negative order moment. Not only positive Q value, but also negative one. When you do that, you can prove that the Lejeune transform of tau of Q, which is what Stéphane was saying yesterday, the Lejeune transform of tau of Q is the D of H spectrum that you look for. Tau of Q linear, the slope of the line is the H you are here. Tau of Q nonlinear, each slope corresponds to a value of H, you are multifractal. So doing this, tau of Q is an estimator of whether you are monofractal, tau of Q is a line, or multifractal, tau of Q is nonlinear. Okay, now we have tested, so we have done the theoretical part, we have tested, we have implemented algorithm and in 2D, and we have tested the algorithm on fractional Brownian surface. Fractional Brownian surface like that, with order, with index 1/3, you do everything I have explained, you do log of the moment at a given scale as a function of log of the scale for different value of Q, you do linear regression, you estimate tau of Q, you draw tau of Q as a function of Q, straight line, slope 1/3, you recover H. You check that those rough surfaces are monofractal, tau of Q is linear, and the slope is H, the index. And you recover for different value of H, everything works. Now, we do that for a multifractal surface that you have generated, and you know the D of H, the theoretical D of H, which is the blue here. You do the same, and now you get a tau of Q, which is nonlinear, the Lejeune transform is this, and it fits very well the theoretical spectrum. Okay, now with that tool, methodology, we're going to start analyzing thermogram. And in thermogram, the doctor knows that there are two main kind of breast tissue. Fat breast tissue, rather old woman, dense breast tissue, rather young woman. They are very smart Dionysus, breast cancer for fat tissue, old women. They are not so good for dense tissue, young women. And the problem is for young, for old women, where they are smart, cancer evolves very slowly. Not so dangerous. Many women die from with a breast cancer, not for breast cancer, for other reasons. It evolves very slowly. For young women, cancer evolves very fast. They have dense breasts, and that's where the problem. The doctors are really challenging situation, very difficult situation. What we have done, we have started to analyze dense breasts. Okay, I don't want to use tau of Q, linear, D of H, H 0.6, 0.7, which means very much like fractional Brownian motion surfaces, long-range correlation, long dependence. We have analyzed fat. And fat, you have in front of your eyes, no way to not to distinguish between the two. Still monofractal, but the older exponent now is 0.3. Anti-correlated rough surfaces. So which means, with this technique, it is very easy to do this. You have different breasts, and you can, I don't know if you see. Oh no, can we switch off? Okay, I don't know if you see, but here you have, we took square, and each square we put a color, red, if it is 0.6, blue if it is 0.3 in the range. And we can do segmentation of the breast, and you can define in a given breast, square where your tissue is fat, where the doctors are very good, from square where the tissue is dense, where the doctor have to focus more. Okay? So, but monofractality, and the question was, with this kind of technique, can we detect microcalcification? And the answer is yes, as you can see. If you look at the way the Weavett coefficient behave along the maxima line, along the blue line here, as you can see, this is log of the wavelet, the modulus as a function of log of the scale, the wavelet coefficient, instead of decaying like 0.6, they increase, which means H negative. What does it mean that locally H is negative? If you have a delta distribution, H is minus 1. So which means microcalcification corresponds to small delta peak, that locally, where locally the Weavett coefficient have this kind of very different behavior. They increase from large to small scale instead to decrease. So you do this analysis, you detect the blue line, you look at the fractal dimension of the microcalcification cluster, and then you end with this. I'm going to skip. You end with this. When you have benign, so actually, when a woman go to have mammograms, they take two views. They do this, they take one view like that, they do this, they take one view like that. So you have two views. So for each view, when the fractal dimension of the microcalcification you get are either integer one or two, benign. So which means when the microcalcification are along line or surfaces, which is necrosis tumor, is malign. When the fractal dimension you can see in red is about 1.5, 1.4, 1.6, which means the microcalcification have branch, malign. But the question is, with this, it's already too late. When you do this diagnostic and you are in this situation, it's already too late for the woman. Okay? Now, okay, that was what we have done 10 years ago. Now let's go to more recent result, thermograms. Thermograms, so now you have infrared picture of temperature on the skin of the woman, of the breast, that you have here. And what you can do, so poor spatial resolution, but what you can do is, now you look at a given point and you look at what's happening in time. So you have women that are seated like that, as you can see, on a chair, 15 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and during 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you record 70 pictures per second, you record the fluctuation of temperature. And what you get is this. So what do you think that the doctor in Perm were doing with this? They were looking at the oscillation. Oscillation, two frequency. One heartbeat, one per second. The second one, breathing, one every 5 seconds. And what the doctor were doing is they were trying to see when there is a malign tumor underneath, do we see change in the frequency, in those two frequencies, or in the amplitude of the two frequencies. No interesting result. And we start to see, and of course the doctor said the noise that you see, that you see here, is experimental noise. Has nothing interesting in. This is not true. In many physiological signals, not only this, many physiological signals, there might be some interesting physiological information in the fluctuation you record. And this is what you're going to see. Analyzing those fluctuations using the 1D wavelet transform modulus maxima method, I skip, you see the same, I skip many things, and this is what we get. So the noise, we accumulate the noise, the signal, to from a noise non-continuous to get a continuous signal. And we do one-dimensional wavelet transform modulus maxima method, and we compute tau of Q and D of H for, in red, this is the friend of the Russian student that came in Bordeaux working with us. So you look at the normal breast, you look at the fluctuation of temperature above those oscillatory behavior, and what you get is a nonlinear tau of Q multifractal dynamics. Multifractal dynamics. You take a woman who has breast cancer, on that breast, you take the other one. You do the same analysis, same nonlinear, the black, same multifractal dynamics. And now you take the malign tumor area on the other breast, and you look at temperature fluctuation, and surprisingly, you get a linear behavior, you get a monofractal situation. So which means that healthy tissue, healthy breast tissue, fluctuation of temperature over the skin is more complex multifractal that the fluctuation of temperature on the top of a malign tumor. How can we understand this? Of course, we have confirmed. I'm going to skip a lot because of time, but let's see what we can do is this. Excuse me. What we can do here is we can again segment the breast by small square. In each square, we compute the D of H. When the width of the D of H is large enough, we are multifractal, you put a blue square. And when it is shrinked like a point, monofractal, you put red. This is a normal breast. This is the opposite breast, and this is a cancer breast. The tumor is here. You can see that over the tumor, almost all the squares are red, monofractal. So we have done a lot of statistics. And at the end, let's see the over 33 patient woman that had breast cancer, we had 25 true positive. The 8 that we missed are situations where the tumor was deep inside the breast, more than 10 centimeters from the skin. So when the tumor is too deep, you don't see monofractal, no change in the dynamic. But if not, you detect. How can it be? What does it mean that the dynamics become of the fluctuation simpler when you are on the top of a malign tumor? Let's solve it equation in an homogeneous medium. What will you get? You assume that the breast is completely homogeneous, no structure. What do you get on the skin? Monofractal. It equation. So which means What do you get if you do a modeling of the breast by successive shell structure, highly structured medium? What you get on the skin? Multifractal fluctuation of temperature. So which means it might mean the observation of monofractal fluctuation over a malignant tumor might mean that underneath the structure of the breast has been totally destroyed. Okay, so that brings us back to two mammograms. And we say, can we go back to mammogram, get new data with around tumor, and to see whether with mammogram X-ray analysis, we can see some change in the roughness of the mammograms around the malign tumor. So this is a benign tumor here. We repeat the analysis and we get here less than 0.4, here large, so which is fat, dense, as before. Now, this is a benign tumor. We get here dense and a new color here. Here you are blue or red, but here a kind of yellow new color, which corresponds to H1-alpha. No more correlation between the roughness. H1-alpha very much like if around malign tumor, the structure, the underneath structure of the breast tissue has been decorrelated, disorganized. And now the question is, of course, those yellow, now I can tell you that those yellow squares are exactly where we got monofractal time fluctuation. And now at that point we thought, oh, it's easy to understand. When the tumor starts to grow, a malign tumor starts to grow, she's destroying the breast tissue, disorganizing the breast tissue, that's the yellow, and then temperature propagates in a more homogeneous medium, and you go from multifractal to monofractal dynamics. But, and then we end with this. So we, 2 years ago, we get aware of this paper by Mina Bissell group in the United States. Mina Bissell group, they have done for years, they have accumulated data from dead people that died by accident of any age, and they have looked at, they have to look at autopsy, and they have accumulated so many data that they claim, and that in every one of us here, we have in our body many, many sleeping tumors. Malign. And what she has been fighting for years, Mina Bissell, and that now many groups converge to what she has been saying for at least 10 years, and in particular the group we are working in at the hospital in Lyon, is the following. Mina Bissell claimed that we don't have to focus too much on cancer cells. What we have to focus on are the cells that are around the tumor, that are called the niche. And the niche cell, we have evidences, many evidences today now, that the function of the niche cell is to produce protein to feed the tumor, to make the tumor happy to be sleeping. Of course, it's an approximation zero of the real truth, but this is exactly what she has been fighting to try to convince the doctor that don't focus so much on looking at the cell tumor, the cancer cell, and so on. Look at what's happening around. Why? Because the tumor starts to grow much after the niche cell starts to be deregulated. So which means what's happening is that the dysregulation of the niche cell is going to lead to the growth of the tumor. So which means that if I go back to what I was showing before, which means that those yellow squares might be there before the tumor start growing. And this is the challenge we have today. So which means to bring the proof that those yellow squares where the structure of the breast seems to have been destroyed, where the dynamic of the fluctuation seems to be more simple, monofractal, as a consequence, to show that before the doctor diagnoses the cancer. How to do that? We need to have what doctors say, longitudinal studies. So, suivi. 10 years, 15 years of every year, you have a mammogram for the same woman, and after some years, she gets diagnosis cancer. This is very hard to get. You imagine why? Because if you are young, you are 25, one day you feel something wrong in your breast, you go to the doctor, they diagnose cancer, next year you are dead. So which means you don't have any kind of possibility to have a real significant suivi for young women. Okay, no way for us to get suivi in France. All the hospital, you try to explain this, all the hospitals say, we have no time. Okay, so let's forget that. So finally, 2 months ago, we succeeded in buying 150 suivi, longitudinal study, in United States in some hospital. Today, we have analyzed 2, which means forget it, women above 50. Of course, 2 means nothing. The results are surprising. Not surprising, very encouraging, but it means nothing, as we know. But yes, we see yellow square much before the woman was diagnosed cancer breast, biopsy, cancer confirmed. Okay, so which means what we are doing now, but as I say, it will be concerning only women older than 40, 50 years old, because we don't have. We should do it on purpose. Some hospitals should trust what we are doing, take few women, normal women, enough, which means 40 over 100,000, for to see at least one show the cancer during, which is, okay. So, but anyway, we hope in the next future to confirm on the set of longitudinal study we have, that we might anticipate cancer diagnosis by months and even years. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.